अस्मदाचार्य पर्यन्तं वन्दे गुरु परम्पराम्। ओम सहना भवतु सहनौ भुनक्तु सह वीर्यंकरवावहै तेजस्विनावधीतमस्तु मा विद्विषावहै। ओम शांति शांति शांति। So the question that has been asked is how can I have a desire for the Atma, right? Because following that, there are some steps. Okay, one second. I think Nitya. Oh, Joao has not got a link. Okay, one second. So I'm a little confused now. Can somebody send? Okay, please email him. Yeah, or please like in the Google chat. Please tell him. Okay. So let me continue. So this desire for Atma, yeah. I want to talk a little bit about the subconscious mind. So without going into many details, I just want to say that the subconscious mind is a storehouse of several sensations and ideas and memories and thoughts and emotions. And it also gives rise to a sense for most people that I am not okay as I am. Okay, most people have that. And we have to discern that this is a very unusual and persistent pattern. So the desire for Atma is never experienced as a desire for the Atma, okay? Rarely ever, because the question is, first of all, what is the Atma? Secondly, by knowing the Atma, so what? Or by experiencing the Atma, so what? So just to have a desire for the Atma is also not logical, because Atma is you. You can only desire what you don't have. So if you are desiring the Atma, that means there is, you don't have it, okay? Or you are not it. So like that, there's a lot of confusion around this Atma. And here in Sadhana Panchakam, in the previous verse, he's saying that may you discern this Ichha for Atma. So here, through the process of living, through an examination of my many experiences, I find that I am struggling with feeling good. So I don't feel good. I want to feel good, I don't feel good. And then all of us, we have different strategies in how to feel good. And this feeling good is really centered on myself, on who I have taken myself to be. So all these attempts to feel good, to think I am significant, to see that I am adequate, to see that I am free from self-judgment, it's not easy to achieve. We try, we don't succeed. And by coming to Vedanta, we are able to actually give our search a certain direction. So earlier I was just experimenting with a lot of things to be okay about myself. Now I'm beginning to understand that this sense of dissatisfaction that is there throughout my life, it's not because I want a lot from life. It's not because, you know, somebody has been very nasty to me. It's not because I'm very greedy. It's just something I cannot shake off. And the Shastra very clearly explains that actually is very good. Very good if you are restless. Very good if you're feeling not quite settled. Because you are not looking for anything ordinary, you are actually looking for yourself. That self which is not understood, and therefore you are looking for it. And so this search, which was like a headless chicken search, now gets a direction. And the direction is that Atma, that which is the source of all adequacy, all shanti, it is really you. That's the pratignya, that's the statement of the Shruti. So then you think, acha, if that's how it is, then I want it. I definitely want this Atma. And then there is a whole process for it. Okay? So your question in terms of discerning the Atma, that itself takes a long time. You know, discerning that there is a separate search, that no matter what I do, no matter how much I do in my life, it's not enough. You know, it's not enough for me to get what I want in terms of total fulfillment. In terms of little, all that is possible. But total fulfillment is not possible. Not because I'm not trying hard enough, but I'm trying in the wrong direction. So, I remember this during our course, I think I've shared this earlier also with you all. Somewhere towards the third year, in one of the satsangs, Swami Sakshatji, he said that even if by the end of your course, y'all have Purushartha Nishchaya, meaning y'all have a clear idea of the fact that moksha is a distinct pursuit and that you are committed to that pursuit. So even if you have Purushartha Nishchaya by the end of the course, I think it will be a great achievement. Okay? And we were shocked. We were like, here, you know, people have given up jobs, sold off their whatever, rented apartments. They've come here to study, and this is all he's saying. Like, either that we are not committed as a group, or is that all that one can expect at the end of a course? You know, so some of us, we did go to him. And of course, he laughed it off. I thought there was a lot of truth in what he said, which is that you can go through courses, camps, retreats, but still not clear about the distinctness of this pursuit. You know, and that's why this statement in Sadhana Panchakam is not an ordinary statement. That may you discern, may you desire the Atma, because there is a mix-up. Therefore, it is necessary to consider the Atma initially as distinct from everything else. After some time, then, you know, that understanding becomes all-encompassing. But initially, it's important because then the search is more has more direction. Yeah, is that okay? Okay. Then continuing with the other sadhanas, okay, so there were, I think where we stopped was really you know, acquiring these many qualities. So shama, etc., shama, dama, all of that, which you all have looked at in Tattva Bodha. And like I said, we you know, we are accountable for our growth. Okay, so it is not something that somebody is going to check with you about. So how are you doing in terms of your acceptance of situations, etc.? That you, because you're committed to this pursuit and acquiring, cultivating more of these qualities, so then you are alert, and from time to time you check with yourself in terms of how you are doing. And further he goes on to say that if you have the necessary qualification in terms of the various qualities, then what else do you need to do? But you can santyajyatam, you can give up very nicely karma. Okay, so whatever karma is to be done, may you give that up very firmly. Okay, dridhataram. So now again, you have to look at this statement from two standpoints. One is from the standpoint of a total commitment. If you are committed to a pursuit and you want to discover the Atma, and you're not willing to postpone it for until very later, then what are you wasting time for? Just go ahead, go on the fast track and take to sannyasa. Okay, why sannyasa? Because it is, you are basically qualifying yourself in a way that you are disqualifying yourself from everything else in life. Okay, it's a very weird kind of a qualification. You're basically rendering yourself as useless for anything else. So you are not employable, nor can you be an employer. So you're basically out of a job, and you don't want to also be in a job, because even if people offer you, you don't want. So then that's fast track, because if that's your commitment, then you go all out for it. It's like how people, you know, when they have a startup. So then from a peon to a CEO, that's the kind of job that most people who will have a startup, they will work. They work so hard only because they are committed to whatever is their goal. So it's just about goal orientation, really, that if this is all that you want in life, then of course you can give up karma. Don't run away from karma, but give it up through the ritual of sannyasa. So santyajyatam. So that's one way of looking at it. The other is that when can I really give up karma? Because as you all would have seen in the third chapter, Bhagavad Gita, that nobody can sit quiet or even for a second without doing karma. It's just not possible. You have to act, or you have to think you are acting. Acting meaning doing some karma. So then nobody can sit quietly like this. So then what is the karma to be given up and why? And here is where reminding us of the achiever orientation that all of us have and need to have. Okay. Why I'm saying achiever orientation? Because you explore the whole field of karma to such an extent that you have allowed karma to work for you in terms of your growth. So if you have an achiever orientation, which you really need to have, you know, for the study of Vedanta, you want to learn to push yourself in terms of the capacities of your body and mind. So don't settle for less. You know, Bhagwan was very, very ambitious when he manifested as the Jagat. You just look at the variety. It is mind-boggling. You know, especially if any of you all have done snorkeling. So on the earth now, we have become so jaded, we cannot appreciate the variety that's there, you know, on the earth. But you go below meaning under the water, in the waters. And such weird shapes and such different colors. It's such a riot of colors. And so many animals, fishes, corals that you have never ever seen in your life. You don't know their names. And the level of variety, it is really mind-boggling. So Bhagwan is not held back. So there is no reason why you should not be ambitious. Okay, ambitious in life. And that ambition will come from an achiever orientation that you have to push in terms of your own karma, in terms of your artha, kama, dharma pursuits, so that you recognize where karma can take you and where karma cannot take you. And for you to understand where karma cannot take you, unless you push yourself, you will not know. Because after some time, you have to give up this achiever orientation. Because to know yourself, you have to give up all will, all effort. But you can give up will, you can give up your effort only when you have exercised it to a certain optimal level. And where can you exercise your will? It will be in the many pursuits. So don't settle for less. If it is in terms of making money, make lots of money. You know, if you want to reach out to people, try and reach out to as many as you can. Even in terms of pleasure, you know, as long as it's in line with dharma, definitely have a lot of pleasurable experiences. Enjoy the good things of life. There's nothing wrong with it, you know. Because Bhagwan very clearly he says, so I am that kamaha which is not opposed to dharma. Very clearly. So there's no reason to feel guilt. Explore and enjoy your life. In the name of Vairagya, don't hold back. Okay, don't hold back. No, 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 I can't do this. No, 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 I won't do this. So in the name of Vairagya, people become very scared. Okay. They foster a culture of fear and then they say, no, 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 but I have a lot of vairagya, I am very objective, and they are so scared. So then there is somebody, oh, one woman is walking by, oh my God, I better look in that direction, etc., etc. This is not vairagya, this is fear, you know. So this is ridiculous actually, that you are saying that this image of somebody walking by is enough to disturb you. Then what kind of vairagya is that, you know? So that's just fear, okay? We are not talking about that. So I will be able to give up karma only when I recognize what karma can do and what karma cannot do. So in knowing something, no amount of karma will help me. Okay, in knowing that this is a computer screen, I can do Shirshasana also. I can stand on my head. Okay, but this computer screen will continue to be a screen. It's not going to transform into something else. I can do a lot of japa also, you know, but the screen will continue to be that. I can have a lot of organic food also, or I can fast, or I can do puja. So many things I can do, so many sadhanas are there, but in terms of seeing something as is, no amount of karma will help me. And for me to be able to clearly understand that, I have to push myself in terms of karma. And I can push myself as much as required because I have the attitude of karma yoga. So that is what insulates me, that is what protects me, that is what inspires me to achieve tremendous growth. Because whatever you want to achieve, you have Arpana Buddhi, Ishvara Arpana Buddhi, you have Prasada Buddhi, then what is that to stop you? Then what is the fear? Even the fear you offer to Ishvara, that's fine, no problem. You know? So much anxiety there. That's okay. You know, Ishvara will take it all, no problem. We'll give it back to you nicely as nice Prasada. We'll transform it. You know, and will give you a sense of reassurance, whatever it is that you require. And so no problem. So this fearlessness, there is a certain relative fearlessness that comes from doing whatever it takes in our many pursuits. You know, so this is important. Don't hold back. Do whatever you need to in your artha, kama and dharma pursuits. Because when the time comes to recognize the limitations of karma, then you are very clear. You're very, very clear. Otherwise, what happens very often is people come to Vedanta. They are, whatever may be the trigger. And then they get very disillusioned. Because they say, oh, but there's nothing to do. You know, like, give me something to do in Vedanta. So they say, oh, what is this, just listening and all? I'm sure that these rishis, they were not up to date with experiential methods of learning. So there has to be something interactive. There must be something to do. Or these teachers, whoever I happen to be in touch with, is it that they are not creative enough? So why they are not making me do something? Okay. So this is not because there's something wrong with the rishis, but because I have not understood how I have to learn. Because there's a way in terms of how learning needs to take place. And because I am unfulfilled in my field of karma, so I'm looking to do something and I'm getting disillusioned. And suppose if I tell also, chalo, you know, definitely meditate every day 10 minutes. But people don't do it. Okay? So much for saying, nope, you give me just one, give me one discipline, I will do it. So I don't ask because I know that all of us are not able to do it. Okay, so it is not for any other reason, but because we have not learned to push ourselves in our world of functioning. Because all of us live in different worlds, you know, our own mini worlds. And if you push yourself, meaning you what goes in modern parlance as maximizing your potential. Then there is a lot of fulfillment there. And with Karma Yoga Buddhi, it is such a blessing. You know, you can be very ambitious and you can thoroughly enjoy it. So here when it is being said that may these enjoined actions, okay, may they be given up through sannyasa, there is a little bit of a journey to be followed. What is the journey? That first, kamya karma, all the things that I really want from my life, may I get that? For that, karma kanda or the different rituals are there as a helping hand in case I want. Okay, in case I want a helping hand. So now not enough rains and so much global warming. So then there is something in the karma kanda section that can help me. Oh, normal methods tried, no child. Okay, you can, if you want, then it's there. Ritual is there to have a child. So the whole Veda is centered to help me. And because I have a lot of desires, it is not saying you have more desires. Okay, the Veda doesn't say you please have more desires. If since you have so many desires, you can have a helping hand and you can achieve all that you want, all your kamya karma. Then after some time, if you've lived a relatively fulfilling life, then you're not really, you don't want the big stuff. Okay, the big things is simple stuff you want, and or you may just want to maintain a certain status quo. And then your vihita karma as in karma to be done daily, your daily puja, etc. So all that, if you come to, then that is being done daily, because we are trying to neutralize the impurities, and there's so much papa, right? Every day is unfolding, and we also want punya for our life pursuits. So there will come a time when I might outgrow even the need for that. That, you know, this punya papa, it has served its purpose. It has brought me to this pursuit. And there's nothing more that I want. So then sannyasa becomes relevant. Otherwise, if I have lots of desires, but I don't have a field within which to achieve them, then it's very, very inappropriate, you know, to actually want to give up karma. Because the Shastra, validates this search of mine and says, okay, even the daily puja, in fact, your relationship with Agni, with fire, no more there. No more there in the sense, since you are saying you don't want to go to Swarga, you don't want to hang out with the Apsaras. Okay, great. Since that's, you're making it very clear, then no more relationship with Agni. So sannyasa, in that sense, you then become unfit for anything else. That's how you disqualify yourself. But here, the way we want to look at it is really that giving up karma comes from the understanding of karma. Because all jnanis also do a lot of karma. But the karma they do is not out of a sense of kartritva. It is not out of sense of doership. It is not for the sake of happiness or fulfillment. The karma that is undertaken is out of a sense of fulfillment. Okay, so then karma, one has the right perspective for that. Okay. So here also, for some time, being in an ashram is very good. It may be few weeks, it may be few days. Because you find that you're not doing much, okay? And that it's okay. Because a lot of us struggle with not doing anything. We feel very restless. You walk into the house, then there are, like most people will want to switch on music. or will want to switch on the TV, or you will start to read the paper. I knew somebody who was such a compulsive reader, so went on holiday and forgot his books. Then what to do? So only the menu, you know, the restaurant menu was there in the room. So obsessively now he's memorized the whole restaurant menu, you know, for the entire family. Because compulsively reading, like, I feel so restless because I have nothing to read. There's no newspaper. What kind of a hotel this is? And created a big fight that, oh, this hotel has nothing to read, no newspapers, nothing like that. He's saying, no, but sir, you are here to relax. Saying, what do you mean relax? I have to read something. Okay. So we are not used to just being. You know? Although the word is human being, but we have obsessively become human doings. You have to do something or the other, do. If not anything else, I have to meditate, I have to do japa, I have to do this, I have to do that. So it is very, very obsessive. So here, that little time that you can just be and be okay about it. Because some of us will say that, oh, you know, I just vegetated. So I feel so useless at the end of the day. So kya kiya? Nahi, kuch bhi nahi kiya. So what a useless day. What an unproductive day. Okay, but you were okay. You were with yourself. That's it. No. I have to be very productive. Okay. So this work orientation, if we are not alert about it, it creeps up that one has to always be productive. And majority of the people, they feel very guilty to go on vacation because they feel they have not deserved it. So they have to work really, really hard, you know, up till the day of the vacation. Then the first 2 days of the vacation, they will just sleep it out because they were working so hard. And then to feel, finally now, I think I deserve my holiday. Because if I've not been doing much, then you feel like, yeah, I'm a worthless person. And this feeling worthless and feeling unproductive is because I have not really pushed myself in terms of karma. Then I'm struggling with it. Whereas if you have really worked like a dog, and this is, I encourage it, you must work like a dog and a donkey combined. So then that's enough. Bas ho gaya, like, you know, you have no desire anymore to push yourself in terms of karma. And for some it may be few years, for some it may be more years. I don't know. You know, it's different for different people. Because also, you know, you look at the way plants and animals, the way they function. There's no holding back. You know, the flower will bloom, the trees will continue to blow, they will continue to give oxygen. There's no holding back in the way they function, you know. So even in scientific experiments, what the amount of oxygen that the plant has to give will give. There's no, let me say, for a rainy day or any such. So then what are we holding on to, you know? So even in terms of our contributing to society and all that, what is that back, really, you know? So here, karma and the perspective on karma is very clear. And then he says, Sad Vidvan Upasripyatam. So now that you know you have understood the limitations of karma, may you approach a Vidvan. May you approach a guru, in other words. So earlier he had said that may you associate with people who are committed to the truth. So sangaha, satsu vidhiyatam. So now there were lots of good people are committed to the truth. Maybe lots of gurus also. But please zero in on your search and may you approach a guru. Okay? And may you approach the guru properly. So properly, and this properly is given a lot of importance in our Shastra. So the word properly, the equivalent of it in Sanskrit has been mentioned in several places. So now this approaching a guru, what kind of a guru? We have seen in Mundaka Upanishad, so somebody who is a Shrotriyam and a Brahmanishtha. So we are, in other words, Vidwan, the one who has Vidya. So what Vidya? The knowledge of the scriptures. So when you are approaching a guru, you don't go with a sense of entitlement that I am going to somebody, he better teach or she better teach. You actually don't know, because the teacher has every right to say, sorry, I cannot teach you. Okay? Or you please go do something and come back. You're not yet ready. So anything the teacher can say. So this properly approaching a guru, if traditionally was said, you know, with the twigs. Twigs meaning that some sort of firewood is used in all ashrams. So the traditional setup. And fuel is so important because it literally fuels the activities of the ashram. And so therefore you approach the guru with something that is useful. And also it indicates a certain readiness to serve the guru. Okay. And traditionally, this is it's a traditional practice, no more now, we see, but that when you, if you're meeting somebody like a king or you know, now we'll say a politician or a guru or somebody who is elder, you don't go empty-handed. You always go with something. It could be fruits, you know, it could be something very small if you can't afford much, but never go empty-handed. Okay, so that's in terms of a particular, it's a practice. And this, it's still the prerogative of the guru to teach you or not. Okay. So because what has been said earlier is that if you have this clear desire for Atma, you have cultivated all these many qualities, you have discovered the limitation of karma, then what else is there but for you to get the teaching? So now teaching has to be got, and it cannot happen by reading books. It cannot happen also by listening to several videos or by watching. So this watching several videos has become an epidemic now. Okay, it's become an extension of how we used to just devour books. So books on spirituality, now you watch lots and lots of videos. And the problem with that, okay, see, there's an advantage in it in the sense that the exposure is tremendous and one can be exposed to a lot of thought. But the problem with it is that it will contribute to confusion, because you don't know where the pieces of the puzzle fit, because the view is not clear to you. So how all the pieces of the puzzle fit together, you don't know. Somebody is emphasizing Ashtanga Yoga. Somebody is emphasizing Kundalini. Somebody else is emphasizing Shakti Upasana. So now what do you do? Okay. And of course, we being quite arrogant, we'll say, no, I'll figure it out. It's okay. But we'll figure it out. May you lose out a lot of time and also get lot of ulta samskar. Ulta meaning it's not correct. So people will say in Rishikesh, ki ye to ulta samskar hai. Means you've learned wrong things. Now first you have to correct that, you have to unlearn that, and only then be able to learn something new. So this epidemic, I'm being very careful about the choice of my words. It's a disease. It's a compulsive disease. I have to watch this. I have to watch that. Da, 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 all that is because there is no surrender to a guru. So, but why is that important? It's important because the Shastra very ambitiously states that the one who has a teacher knows. Acharyavan Purushah Veda. So the one who, only the one who has a teacher, a guru, can know the truth. And it is important to establish a relationship with the guru. So what do I mean by that? What I mean is that there needs to be some accountability. Okay? See, in every other relationship, there is some accountability. So as you relate to your father, mother, children, etc., or even to your boss. So there is a certain rough script that more or less we follow. Now, with the guru, what is it? It's primarily your learning. Your learning, and that happens because of the teaching. So, because of my commitment to learning, I am accountable. Whatever has been told to me to do as my sadhana, it needs to be done by me. So generally, most gurus will tell you what is to be done. If they don't tell you, you have to pester them. Okay? You have to pester them, you have to ask them, so what do I need to do for my growth, etc. And, in our course, we would have an interview with Pujya Swamiji in the beginning of the course, then somewhere midway, and also at the end. So just for him to know how we are doing. It was a formalized structure in terms of meeting him. So either meeting him over lunch or something like that, And so this was a definite thing. Of course, in addition to that, we could meet him as in how we wanted to or needed to. So that was a separate matter. And this is a very important thing about being a part of, having a live guru. Because the teacher needs to know how you're doing. That's the only commitment, right? That the teacher is committed to you knowing the truth. And you are also committed to the same. So then, you have to seek some time as you find appropriate to discuss areas about your growth. And it may not be, it may not very comfortably come to you, because people have all sorts of reasons, excuses. Some people may say that, I don't want to disturb this person. Hey, but it is your right as a student. It is your right as a student to ask for time. So, but anyway, people say, no, I don't want to disturb, or I don't want to say. Then it's okay. You have a right to privacy. So you need not. But in the whole thing, just be careful that your growth is not being compromised or shortchanged. Because this these are things I have to state, because these are not obvious things which you will know if you are studying in an ashram. These things will come to you, but otherwise it's not very obvious, and also what happens is in an ashram setup, even if the person doesn't ask you for time, the student doesn't ask you for time, Still, because one is involved in a lot of activities, collective activities, they could be fundraising activities, or it could be cleaning the dining hall kind of activity, some seva activity around the ashram, then one is always able to see as a guru how the students are doing. You know, what is the level of accommodation? See, because you are thrown in with a bunch of people from different cultures and you're working together and all are adults, okay? So adults meaning everybody is very independent minded and everybody has their own way of doing things. And definitely there's a lot of friction. So a lot is observed while collective activities are being done in an ashram, and or even for that matter a retreat. And therefore, you know, the guru is able to point out certain things. Because if you really look at it, what is the motivation for the guru to teach? You know, it surely can't be dakshina, okay? Because you know, you have a very simple lifestyle anyway, so then what will you do with it? Unless you have a lot of other activities that require funding. But still, even in India, I find that things are changing, you know, just from the standpoint of dakshina. In the sense that in our course, which was the last course where no money was being charged, you know, to the students. So three and a half years, and it has been a free course. And it was suggested that for those who could afford, they could contribute an amount of 5,000 rupees per month. So primarily to take up electricity as well as food costs. Now, this current course that is on in Anikatti, one of the conditions they've had to very reluctantly put forward is that almost everybody has to contribute 8,000 rupees per month. Now, why was this necessary? Okay, it was with great reluctance. Pooja Swamiji, my God, I don't know how he agreed to, you know, for this to be asked, because he would, you know, he would just say, no, we will just keep this and money will come from somewhere. But money doesn't come. You know, dakshina doesn't come. So people have very weird ideas. They think that ashrams and sadhus live on love and fresh air, you know. So medical expenses are there. So much, and especially in a forest. So you can imagine the generators and the electricity that needs to be generated over there, even with the solar panels, okay? So because if electricity goes, which very often it did, then immediately generate